We'll get started. Okay, welcome everyone. Like I said, probably give it another 30 to 45 seconds and then we'll get started. Okay, I think we'll get the show on the road and get started. Hi everyone, my name is Stephanie Garty. I'm one of the Chief Pharmaceutical Officers Clinical Fellows working within the Transformation Directorate at NHS England and Improvement. Welcome to our June ePrescribing Masterclass. Very thankful for all of you who have joined us and given up your hour to come and listen to our speakers today. And if I can ask everyone to use the hashtag ePrescribing Masterclass on Twitter and LinkedIn and any social media, and just to promote the session. The session is being recorded, so it's available here and it will be available on YouTube as well. It'll be available on the NHS Futures workspace and for anyone who couldn't attend for today. So today, like I said, we've got a packed agenda. Today's focus is actually on antimicrobial stewardship. I know we've had one of these previously, 6 months ago, but it's quite an important topic. And this is where electronic prescribing systems and digital medicine systems can play a huge part in optimizing antimicrobials and antibacterials. I'm pleased to have our next speakers come and speak. So we've got Dr. Saeed Gilani, who's the Principal Pharmacist of Antimicrobial Therapy at the Dudley Group NHS Trust, as well as Pam Pahar, who's also the Principal Pharmacist for Digital Medicines and EPMA Systems, also at the Dudley Group, who are coming to speak to us first. So after their session, there'll be time for you to ask questions. So if you've got any questions, please put them in the questions tab. And we've got 5 minutes to ask some questions. Then after that, we've got a couple of talks about the EPAMS project, which is going to be introduced today. So I'll let Saeed and Pam come and join us. Hi.
Hello, everyone.
Hi. I'll leave you guys to go with your session.
Thank you, Steph. Next slide, please. Okay, so we're just here to share our experiences with the new EPMA system, which we got in August 2020. It's called AllScript Sunrise, and I'll be going through some of the features which encompass antimicrobial stewardship on our day-to-day job. Next slide, please. Okay, so the funny fact is that we went live in the middle of a pandemic, which was in August 2020. I think it was the quieter time. It wasn't the peak. So it was just before the second peak was coming. So we thought that was the right time to roll it out. And because we knew EPMA was going to help us in terms of our clinical workload, avoiding to go to a clinical area when we didn't have to, and all of those other advantages which comes with EPMA. We went live across the trust except pediatrics because we had encountered some issues with bringing the whole department. We have a neonatal ICU as well, so bringing them all to the same table was a bit tricky, so we decided to leave pediatrics out and go with the adults sector first, and then later on come back to the pediatrics. We developed order sets for TDM drugs. We utilized the order sets or order forms, taking into account some of the key fields like indication, etc., which I'll later on show you guys. The dashboards, which were really helpful, and they are actually really helpful on our day-to-day job. Next slide, please. So we have segregated forms for antimicrobials, injectables, orals, and the TDMs, as I've already mentioned, have this set order sets. The weights are pulled in automatically if they have a weight in the patient's demographics, which is recorded on admission. We have a mandatory stop date. We have a mandatory indication, but we have left an option of free texting for indications which are not in our drop-down menu. Microbiology approval tick box. Now, we had some of the plans, but they didn't come into fruition. I'll talk about them a bit later. Warning messages prompt before prescribing. So these are for the antibiotics like carbapenems and broad spectrum restricted antibiotics, Piptaz, etc. Next slide, please. So these are the prompt messages. I know when we were going live, there was a big pushback in terms of any warning message we were suggesting because of the prompt fatigue and click fatigue. And yeah, so we were told not to bring forward a lot of warning messages because that gives the frontline clinicians warning fatigue. Next slide, please. So this is our standard antimicrobial form, which can be used for IV and oral both. Now, as you can see, and I've mentioned that before, the dose, the indication, the frequency, the stop date, the duration, all of those fields are mandatory. Our initial plan was to go with a set number of days, which was 5, but it didn't play out well in our drugs and therapeutics, and we had to compromise on just making it mandatory for the time being and then come back to it later on from the improvement point of view. Now, all of these mandatory field works pretty well. And we have shown a lot of improvement with the data as well, comparative to the pre-COVID time versus the post-COVID. Because we introduced during the pandemic, the benchmarking isn't really easy. As you all understand, across the country, the broad spectrum antibiotic use went high, IV use went high, and all of those factors come into play. But things like reduction in meropenem use, reduction in the percentage of non-compliance in terms of allergy documentation, because it is one of the mandatory fields now. You can't prescribe an antibiotic if you don't have allergy box filled. So those things, which are pretty easy to benchmark, have shown significant improvement for us. Next slide, please. So we have medication order, which is for the standard antibiotic prescription, could be oral, could be IV. And then we have the order sets. Next slide, and I should have an example. Yeah, so this is our gentamicin order set, which basically obviously has a mandatory field of dose, frequency, stop date, and indication. But along with that, we have included the ordering of the peak and trough levels along with it. Now, you don't have to have, because as we know, we only do the trough levels for gentamicin usually, unless it is the twice daily endocarditis dosing, in which case they can untick the peak and just ask for the trough level for gentamicin. The warning message appears as well on the nursing worklist manager as well as the order set for the prescriber. So anybody looking at the drug chart or the nursing side of the drug chart, they will both have a warning message around gentamicin monitoring requirements. Now, we thought it will be foolproof and we'll be 100% compliant in terms of the gentamicin prescribing and monitoring guideline in the trust. But we have found that people still use some ways to work around it. One of them being they just prescribe a stat gentamicin to avoid all of that hassle. So the next step is now we have to look at that. The easier bit around that is that we have got dashboards, so we can pick up on who's prescribing those gentamicin stat doses and individually target them. It's still a lot of work, but it can be addressed. But comparatively, pre-COVID to post-COVID, our gentamicin prescribing and monitoring audits, they both show significant improvement in terms of prescribing and in terms of monitoring both. So we don't see a similar number of datexes per se. Now, we have to look at the time period as well. If it coincides with the junior doctor switch over time, that's where you will see most of your prescribing errors, or that's what we see here at this trust. And then if you compare that data to when they are already in their training, for example, in November time, it's probably not so fair to compare that. But we have looked at it from all angles, and it's shown significant improvement in all sectors. Next slide, please. So this is the bit which came a bit later on. So six months after we rolled out the initial EPMA system, where we wanted something for the 72 hours review or within 72 hours review to basically just satisfy the criteria for having good antimicrobial stewardship systems in place in our electronic prescribing system. The guys who work at the back end came up with this clever solution, so we can have a list of patients who are on antibiotics now on the ward dashboard. So anybody, any clinician, any nurse, prescriber, or pharmacist who looks at the ward dashboard will see a column for antibiotic review. Anybody who's prescribed antibiotics will have that antibiotic mentioned in that column with the date when it was prescribed and a color coding as well. So if it is within 24 hours, it will be green. If it is within 48 hours, it will be amber. And if it's reaching 72 hours or past 72 hours, it becomes red. So that's a really good visual hint for the clinicians or for the nurses or the pharmacist on the ward to pick up on. And it kind of helps them prioritize as well in terms of AMS work. Next slide, please. Now at the back end, if they go onto the actual order set, they have this tiny blue antibiotic review section under every antibiotic. And if they click on that, then it pops up with these options around the review decision. So they could say continue, they could say stop, switch on microbiology advice, switch according to the culture sensitivities, OPAT, switch because of any other reason, switch IV to oral switch, and there's a box for comments. Now this is based on what we had previously on paper, and we've just incorporated into our EPMA now. If used, obviously this is one of the best tools for AMS in our EPMA system, and it kind of pushes the clinicians and make them think about deciding something within that first 72 hours. We are working on improving things in terms of making it mandatory, because currently it is not mandatory. So if they just, the clinicians just ignore it, it will just turn red. Now the nurses will see red, they will see red, we will see red, but nothing has to be done about it. Obviously, when we do our data collection, we'll have all of that data. But in terms of mandating it, it's not currently mandatory. So that's one of the drawbacks of the current system we have. Next slide, please. Yeah, so this was one of the other challenges we had initially to include microbiology in specialty, believe me, for the ward rounds, because we have regular ward rounds on acute medicine, critical care, and chronic care twice a week and sometimes three times a week. And for that reason, we wanted a place to record all of those interventions. Now, we had a pharmacy intervention document, but given that consultants do the award round, that's probably the last thing they're going to look at. We wanted it to be included into our main award round document. So anyone looking at the patient clinically looks at that advice and act on it. Or if we make changes, then it's documented right at the front of their eyes and they don't have to worry about why it was done. And in the checklist, it asks about if the antibiotics were reviewed, if any changes have been made, etc. And that checklist tick box is mandatory as well. Now, the advantages of having a separate specialty on medical notes in terms of microbiology. I mean, my initial suggestion was to make it antimicrobial stewardship, but that wasn't taken up at the point, is that whoever is the lead consultant or registrar, whoever is leading that ward round, definitely looks at the ward round entries at least the past couple of days, and they can pick up on any advice we have provided or any objections or any suggestions we make during our ward rounds. The next slide, please. The dashboard we have basically pulls up anybody who's on antibiotic from the formulary and the non-formulary as well. So we have a separate tab where if somebody has prescribed a non-formulary item, which could be antibiotic or anything else, we get a list of that as well. And then we can narrow it down with dates. If we are looking at, for example, just today, then I could just narrow it down to just today and look at which patients, which area, which consultant, and what antibiotic, including the dosing and everything. So that's a pretty easy way of looking at my day if I am doing the clinical AMS role on the day. And then I can target and prioritize from that list, which is quite easy. Now, we also have the tab around the antibiotic review, which also tells us which ones are post 48 hours, so we can go and target those or ask the ward pharmacist to make them their priority. But they can already see that information on their ward dashboard as well with color coding. Next slide, please. This is something I personally find really easy and helpful, having the personalized patient list on my Sunrise account. So I have narrowed it down to, one of the list, for example, is just simply patients on meropenem and tazosin on a given day. So any day I log in, it refreshes, it tells me all the patients who are currently actively on meropenem and tazosin for that day. And the workload division and prioritization becomes a lot easier. We can target our ward rounds according to that list. We can pick up, we can direct, delegate to the ward pharmacists to go and sort those prescriptions out. And that has ultimately helped us. The only thing which I can say for sure because of the pandemic is that we have reduced the meropenem consumption since we have placed all these tools in our EPMA system. Next slide, please. So future optimization plans. We have a CAP order set, which is almost ready and ready to roll out. It basically takes into account all the factors and calculates the CURB score for you. It also suggests from our guideline, because we feed it in the background, it will tell you what the recommended regime for that CURB score is. So I'm really excited and waiting for it to go live because I think that's going to be the future in terms of then rest of the conditions, and we can target and improve the prescribing in those areas. Optimization of review, it's not, as I said, it's not really working well. That's one of the drawbacks, that people can actually ignore it. It would turn amber and then red, but if there's nothing which is happening, they would just keep on going, ignore it. The other drawback is that once the prescription stops, that color coding still stays on. So because the review was not done, it will still pop up as red. As far as the patient stays inpatient, that patient will stay red on that dashboard, which is kind of confusing sometimes if somebody doesn't look at the date and they go and see the patient. They'll find that that antibiotic was stopped probably a week ago. Data to drive change and decision making. Now data, as we know, with any EPMA, previously we were struggling to get the meaningful data. Now we are just bombarded and loaded with data left, right, center, and it's really difficult to decide what to do with all of that data. So I think picking up the areas which are the priority and then concentrating on that and utilizing the data you've got from the EPMA system. For us, the target is IV to oral PO, IV to PO switch, and reduction in the broad spectrum antibiotic use. So that's what we were already doing in terms of meropenems and tazosines for our trust, and every other trust will have their own restricted lists. And it is it seems like they are paying a dividend, so it's working. Enhanced clinical decision support. So we have actually subscribed to that enhanced clinical decision support module of the prescribing, but we haven't rolled it out. And I think the plan is now to look at it and how to roll it out safely into clinical practice. So that's one of the future plans. Workflow review. So currently the prescribers can see the color coding, they can see the dashboard, but if they wanted to do a review, they will have to go onto the administration section of the chart, which is the workflow manager. And that's where they will see that box, which they have to click and then choose what they have decided. And I think it's just thinking about what can be done to make things simpler and easy, and that's what we think might help towards our goal of making the clinicians use that box, and that would help in the broader antimicrobial stewardship agenda for the trust. Next slide, please. Oh, we're done. Any questions?
Amazing, thank you. And yeah, your presentation was really informative. There's lots of questions. You've created lots of chat within the question box. Pam has been answering quite a few of the questions, but there's some in place. So just to let everyone know that you are using Allscripts, isn't it?
Yes, Sunrise.
Yeah, and the one of the first questions is about stops and mandatory stops. Is it normally a hard stop or short a soft stop that you're using? I don't know if you answered that previously.
So the stop date is mandatory. I mean, we don't give them that stop date, but they have to put a value in it.
And do you find that with the hard stop that IVs normally drop off, or do they carry on normally?
I find that if the prescription reaches the end, that's whether they like it or not. I mean, the clinicians usually do think twice, and usually what I've seen from practice is that they would stop it altogether.
Okay.
Because the minimum duration which I've seen in practice they put is 5 days. So if a patient has had 5 days of tazosine for example, HAP, by then the patient is clinically in my clinical practice they're quite well, and that's when they think we can just step it down and stop it.
Okay, and you said your minimum amount is 5 days. Do you do any shorter? Do you not?
No.
Do you do 48 hours?
You can put 1 day as well, but the minimum I see from the prescribers. So if a consultant is prescribing for them in their head, it is 5 days. A minimum, so they will always put 5 days in a prescription, unless it's a UTI where they put 3 days. But most of the times they'll put 5 days as an indication for antibiotics. Some old school clinicians will stick to 7 days, which are the patients where we have to actually actively target and go and speak to the teams and say they don't really need 7 days of IV antibiotic, the patient is clinically well, et cetera, and make our intervention.
Okay. There's a question, about gentamicin, whether the level was pre-populated or your prescribers need to input within their time within the gentamicin order set.
So the level is not pre-populated.
Okay.
The request is pre-populated in terms of the request is there, so you have to actually fill it or intentionally untake it and say I don't want the level basically. So that's kind of taking the clinical responsibility, and you can make them accountable later on. But initially, if you give them the form right with the prescription, we found that it's really rare for them to then not fill it. And usually the only thing they are asking for is the next time of the level they want. So it's usually, if it's a renally impaired patient, for example, just before the next dose. So before they are prescribing the first dose, so they'll know what the second dose time is. So the prescriber can at the time basically put down the time and date, and the level will be automatically done. The phlebotomist will automatically come and take the levels, or the nurse will pick it up. So that's to avoid the problems we previously had with the paper drug chart, where the pharmacist would put that little green box on the drug chart and nobody would do it. I think that's to avoid those kind of errors where the nurse has to take the bloods, or the phlebotomist has to, because the order is sitting there on the prescription and it's flagged on their system. So they'll have they'll come and take the bloods and do the levels. Now for the next dose, when the drug levels come back, unfortunately it's again down to the nurses and the doctors. The system is only so much clever to, you know, to basically just give you an option, because we don't have the advanced clinical decision support unit, which I'm not sure even if it covers the gentamicin prescribing, that would be decision support, because the electronic prescribing can help you with making decisions, but it can't decide for you. So the clinicians still have to look up the level and decide whether it is safe or not safe to give the next dose.
And on that note, is there plans, I know your system is linked to your EPR, but is there plans for it to link with, say, your pathology system and somehow levels be pre-populated in that way?
I would say yes, in the future we will look at integrating the system together, but we're not there yet. And also our dispensing system, I know that someone had asked that question in the chat as well. So the future is about the integration and obviously having the platform in place and the application platform to sort of like join them up.
Okay, that's great. And in terms of that integration, and kind of goes to the things about using information standards as well, and so we can integrate systems and have interoperability between all the different systems that we use within one hospital trust. There are lots and lots of questions in the chat. I will, but we have to move on. And would it be possible for you two to be able to answer the questions, and we can send it out to the delegates at a later time?
Absolutely, yeah. I'm still working through them, so I'll answer as many of them. No problem.
That's fine. Thank you, everyone, for putting your questions on. So we'll go on to our next speakers. Thank you, Saeed. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you.
Okay. And as we move on, so we have Professor Robin Williams, who's the director of this at the Institute. Sorry. Okay, Director at the Institute of Science and Technology and Innovation at the University of Edinburgh, and Dr. Catherine Creswell, who's also Senior Lecturer at the Usher Institute at the University of Edinburgh, who will be coming to talk to us about EPAMs. So I'll leave them to explain it to you. All right, thank you.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Steph. Thanks for the invitation. We're delighted to have an opportunity to discuss our work. I'm Robin Williams, and this is Catherine Creswell. We're social scientists, and we've spent the last dozen years working very closely together in evaluating various kinds of health information technology, including e-prescribing. And now we're involved in evaluating the introduction of a new tool for antimicrobial stewardship. And we're just the intro, if you can go to the next slide, to the main act, which is Andrew Heed, who's going to demonstrate the tool, assuming he can get onto the onto the online system, which he's struggling with at the moment. Okay, next slide, please. So we've already can take for granted the kind of attempt to improve antimicrobial stewardship, and in particular the use case where somebody coming in, an old person with a temperature, is given prophylactic antimicrobials, but there's a reluctance amongst health professionals to discontinue the prescription when it's not needed. And a sense that although there's good policy for Start Smart and Focus, this policy isn't well supported by existing e-prescribing systems. And so we've developed this tool. EPAM stands for Electronic Prescribing Based Antimicrobial Stewardship, EPAM's intervention for hospital. And that's a tool to help improve antimicrobial stewardship without damaging the quality of care. Next slide, please. And this has been generously funded by the National Institute for Health Research, and they've funded a multidisciplinary collaboration between a number of universities with close association with some hospital trusts. So we're developing an evaluation, and we're evaluating its implementation and its usability. And the intervention we're talking about builds on some behavioral components. We've drawn on a project called ARC, which people may have come across already, but also the tool that we're going to discuss today. And we're also interested in issues about work organization and how these tools are deployed. And the idea is to see if we can safely reduce inappropriate antibiotic use amongst adults. Next slide, please. And in particular, our goal is to reduce antibiotic use without increasing adverse outcomes, because there is a risk of inappropriate reduction of outcomes, as one of the questions in the panel to the first talk highlighted. And there are two bits of kind of non-technical work in this. There are some quantitative researchers who will be modeling and looking at antimicrobial consumption and health outcomes and assessing whether the intervention is allowing us to reduce antibiotic use, and whether there are any adverse outcomes, and whether there are any positive outcomes for better antimicrobial stewardship. So that's the overarching goal of the tool. We as social scientists have a more particular involvement. We've been working with stakeholders and potential users, as well as with the developers, to ensure that the tool is usable and useful. And then we will support the rollout of the tool, and there's going to be a step wedge trial as the tool will be rolled out to, I think it's a dozen hospitals across England, and we will be supporting the rollout and ensuring that we understand the local context, because the context of use may also moderate the impact of the tool. So that's the quick intro, and I don't know whether Andrew's now on board and whether we can hand over to him.
But unfortunately, he hasn't been able to join.
Aye. Okay. How to deal with that situation? Are you convinced he will not be able to?
He's tried quite a few ways to get in, and he's.
We'll happily start the slides. We'll happily talk over them, but I'll have to apologise to people. You're listening to the monkey, not the organ grinder here. So next slide, please, and give me a shout if Andrew turns up. So that's what Andrew is going to talk about. How the tools are developed, what the tool is, and our views about longer term developments. Next slide. And that's who we are. We've already seen that. Next slide. Okay. So the aim of the intervention is highlights two key prescribing moments. That's start, smart, and then focus. So we're supporting actions around initial prescription, and then we're supporting review within 48 to 72 hours. The start smart bit is to make sure that there is an appropriate recording as the prescription is made, including things like allergy documentation. And one of the key elements about the intervention is that we're going to record the indication in the system and include a review date or a stop date or a duration, interestingly similar to the previous presentation. So that's the initial prescription. And then we're going to ensure that there is medication review, timely medication review, to ensure that we can both stop unnecessary antibiotics, we can support a transition from intravenous to oral, if that's possible, we can support a move from broad to narrow spectrum agents, and then ensure that review is repeated over time. Next slide, please. Oh, God, I wish I'd... this is a paper that our colleagues have already written, which indicate the potentiality of e-prescribing systems to better support antimicrobial stewardship, because at the moment, the systems we have don't do all the things that we would like them to do. Next slide, please. So we've been developing the tool with a gang of pharmacists and frontline medics, Jamie Coleman at Birmingham University, you may know of, and the idea is to develop a system. Well, we say design the perfect system, well, the least bad system, design a system that doesn't drive people crazy with undue inflexibility. And there's always a trade-off between having hard stops and mandatory screens, which may be important if a failure to adhere to the guidance is potentially lethal. On the other hand, that can drive doctors crazy. But we've been wanting to understand the world of e-prescribing, the world of microbial prescribing, and build that understanding into the way the system's designed. And in particular, you know, if you look at the people who build these tools, they typically envisage a single prescriber and a single reviewer, and they don't engage with the fact that there's a kind of a flood of people with poor communication between them who are collectively involved in the decisions to prescribe and in the review process. So we've had a series of workshops with stakeholders and practitioners, and their feedback has been built into the system. We've got a prototype that we're about to trial in Newcastle University Teaching Hospital, and we're also developing training and support for the implementation and rollout. And this is a kind of a full mock-up model, which we're going to describe to you now. It's necessarily, the aim is to have a tool that's fairly simple, easy to learn, etc. Next slide.
Hi, Robin.
Yes.
It's Andrew.
Is that Andrew?
It is.
Pleased to hear from you. Andrew, over to you.
Is that okay? Can I just check which slide are you on? Were you just talking about
EPAMs? You're on a slide called EPAMs Plus Feedback. It needs to be much more simple.
Exactly. So I'll just kind of reiterate what Robin said there. We kind of set out the intention of trying to design the perfect system, and then through a process of iteration and kind of demonstration, actually, the general consensus was that we need to try and keep the tool kind of simple as possible. The kind of feedback we got is that when we wanted people to document, you know, what they'd done in terms of an antibiotic review, we wanted them to tick to say they'd had senior review, they'd done IV to oral switch, they checked culture and sensitivities. And actually, they said, can we just make it a single series of clicks so we can just say, this is what we've done as a review. So the compounded review was just literally go make it as few ticks as kind of possible. One of the kind of the feedbacks that we weren't expecting is that we had tended to develop case sets which are based on a particular indication like community-acquired pneumonia or hospital-acquired pneumonia. The general feeling was actually they're probably not that useful, because the way that people tend to prescribe is not necessarily with a confirmed indication, but they're working on, you know, an empiric best guess based on the presentation, usually going for a single antibiotic to get things started, and then they would review afterwards. So the guidelines are really helpful, but having that kind of big upfront build is probably not that useful, which is convenient for me because it's a lot of stuff to kind of keep on top of in terms of maintenance. The only exception might be in areas where the policies are fairly static, so perhaps febrile neutropenia, there's merit in kind of doing that. The other big feedback is that they just wanted to kind of work on one screen within the e-prescribing system, whereas we previously built it with a review in one place, the prescription in another place, and we tried to kind of pull it together. And then the big question was around whether we wanted to put alerts kind of in, and the general opinion was no, but as we've developed it further, people are kind of quite keen on seeing some limited alerts. So if you just jump to the next slide, please, we'll kind of give you a quick overview of what the tool looks like. Basically, what we're trying to do is to kind of combine the prescribing and the review process into a kind of a single screen within our Cerner system. As part of the prescribing process, we've added in a few additional fields. So as well as having, you won't see them very well on that screen, but I'll show one in a little bit more detail. As well as having the DOES and DOES unit and the routes and frequency, we wanted to put in what was the kind of the current diagnostic confidence at the point of prescribing. And that came from something called the ARC study, which was designed to have an educational package so that people could document how confident they were with an infective diagnosis at the point of prescribing, with a view to that enabling whoever was reviewing the prescription to feel a little bit more confident about cancelling the antibiotic, or actually, you know, they thought they were working with an infection so fast we need to think about kind of a step down. So we've kind of taken the same methodology and built it in. We previously had indication as a mandatory field. We looked at kind of two options, having indication as free text, which we currently have, or looking at a drop-down list of indications. The general consensus was that often you are just working with a kind of a working diagnosis and people didn't feel confident about recording the indication against the prescription in case it then turned out to be something different. But what they quite like the idea of is being able to indicate, you know, what body site they thought if there was an infection they were kind of working on. So we've got a body site drop-down, which is kind of respiratory, CNS, liver, or kind of unknown sepsis. And then the indication field is left as a kind of a free text option. So they're kind of new fields that we're going to build in. And the idea is just to try and kind of build a degree of confidence in the ability to challenge the original diagnosis at the point of review. The other thing we've done is we've kind of built in the review process into the same screen that you use for prescribing, so you don't need to jump around. And there's also the ability to pull in things like cultures and sensitivities, therapeutic drug monitoring results within the same screen. And then we've built in some rules to try and prompt people that they need to do the review. So if we jump to the next screen, we'll kind of go through what the kind of the prescribing process looks like. So at the moment, because we're working as part of the kind of the EPAMS research team, we've badged everything as EPAMS. We weren't going to do that originally, but actually that improved buy-in with the kind of this senior team. So you would just search for EPAMS and you'll see a list of the examples that we've got there. We've got about 30 plus kind of antibiotics built, kind of ready to go in the next month or so. But equally, if you search for Kefotaxime, you would find the kind of the same plan available. So you would just select that plan and then jump onto the next slide, please. This is then the kind of the ordering view. So it'll open up the kind of the plan. The first two lines are hyperlinks to kind of external information. So there's a hyperlink into our antibiotic guidelines. And then we were going to put in a link to guidance based on what you should do if you're doing a kind of an IV to oral switch. Initially, when we demoed it, the link to the antibiotic guidelines, people didn't think was that useful, certainly from a kind of an initiation perspective, because they've often already made the decision or they've had a discussion with kind of a senior team and the decision's already made. You're just literally putting it into the system. But actually, when we got them to play with it, they thought actually that thing is probably more useful when you come to do a review. So you're going to review the patient, what are the kind of the options in terms of step down now that we've got cultures and sensitivities, click on there and it kind of gives you the information. The two lines underneath are what we know as kind of outcomes or targets. So one is just a prompt for a pharmacy review and the other one is a review, antibiotic review by kind of medical staff. The line underneath that, which is antibiotic review, is just a kind of a dummy order that I've built into the plan, which I use for the rule base, which kind of prompts people that they need to do the review. And then underneath that is the actual order itself. And so on the right, you've got some kind of drop-down options for the kind of various doses that you would need for that particular agent. In terms of the kind of the overall structure of the plan, they all look exactly the same. They've obviously just got different antibiotics. and the range of sentences you would just vary based on your kind of your local area. But the kind of the core would probably be the same for everybody. Jump to the next slide, please. As part of that kind of overall view, on the left-hand side, there's a kind of little button called Related Results, which for this test patient, there isn't anything in there. But within that screen, you could go and look at recent cultures and sensitivities, gentamicin levels, renal function, new scores, hematology. And you can basically personalize that based on the individual antibiotics or therapeutic drug monitoring. You would put your aminoglycosides kind of within that view, but you wouldn't necessarily have them for other things. And that means you can just review your patient within kind of one screen. We jump to the next slide. This is just the kind of the additional prescribing fields that I kind of talked about a little bit earlier. So we make them mandatory. That's why they're yellow on this screen. So we've got the kind of the working diagnosis, the body system, and the diagnostic confidence. And then if we jump to the next screen, this is what it looks like when you kind of click down on them. So the body system is a pre-coded list of things that we've kind of come up with our infection team. The diagnostic confidence, there's kind of three options, possible, probable, and then kind of prophylaxis. And then the working diagnosis is kind of completely free text. There is an option to put a predefined list and also the option to tailor that list based on the individual antibiotic, but we didn't go down that route. We wanted to keep it as flexible as possible. So then if we jump onto the next slide, please. This is the kind of the review screen. So I don't know if you can kind of see on this slide, you've kind of got three tabs. You've got orders, medication list, and document and plan, but they're all within the same screen. The orders gives you the list of everything that's ordered for the patient, so all of the medication, any cultures and sensitivities, or blood counts. And then document and plan is where you go and record the detail of the review. So you would click on the little arrow next to pharmacy antibiotic review, and then it's a case of tick, 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 and then that's signed off. And the same thing with the antibiotic review. If we just jump onto the next slide, you'll kind of see what that actually looks like. So the person who's reviewing it clicks into that line, and it's just a case of tick, 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 capture the details of what they've done. And depending on what they kind of put in that response, I tailor our alerts to say the EPAMS tool is kind of pending, or it's under review, or it's completely finalized. And finalized would be you've had a kind of a senior clinician antibiotic review or finalized antibiotic prescription. The other ones would be kind of independent. And so that's essentially kind of the tool. So it's using exactly the same kind of underlying prescribing screens that we've got in our system. It's building in kind of the review process at the outset, building in some additional fields to make people feel a bit more confident about challenging the kind of the initial description, and then being able to record it within the kind of the patient's record within a defined antimicrobial plan. So you can kind of just discreetly look at the information that you need at that one time. On the next slide, I think we've got kind of prompt and alerts. So we've got two alerts that are going to support that review process. The first one is kind of relatively passive. When you go into the patient's record, if the antibiotic review was due in 24, 48 hours in the past, it'll just pop up to say, you need to do a review for clarithromycin, go away and kind of sign that off. And then the one that's probably a bit more controversial, which we might not switch on based on a pilot, is a much more restrictive alert, which is based on when you're trying to exit the patient's record. If the review is over 72, kind of 96 hours overdue, then it prevents you coming out of the patient's record. You have to go in and do the antibiotic review before you can kind of come out, which obviously could be really problematic. So we're going to limit it to just medical staff. It's only going to be obviously in the pilot areas that we're working on. It's not going to include emergency patients. And it's only going to work between Monday and Friday, kind of roughly office hours, so 9 to 6-ish, but we might pull that forward. So that's really only for cases where the review hasn't been done at all, and we'll evaluate whether that makes a difference or whether it's kind of problematic. So if we just jump onto the next slide, some of the other things we've kind of done around the project is some kind of supplemental interviews of medical staff and pharmacy staff on their kind of broad opinions on how we manage antimicrobial stewardship. And that's kind of pulled out lots of themes for us to think about and kind of reflect, and that we might kind of feed into kind of the overall design. So that's something which is going to be kind of published hopefully in the future. One of the things we're working on is how to do kind of a data extract for the research team, so we can kind of see what differences the tool making sort of prior to implementation, then kind of putting it into kind of pilot areas and kind of be able to trend that. One of the things that was mentioned on the slides before I was able to jump on is one of the big issues that we had in terms of the kind of the development group is understanding that lots of different systems have got different capabilities, and lots of the same system are implemented to different scopes within different organizations. And also you have different opportunities in terms of the ability to kind of get lab results in and, you know, kind of be able to interact them with clinical decision support. So part of the kind of the data extract is that we're looking to do a pilot of this this tool in a Cerna site, which we are, then share it with some other kind of Cerna sites kind of down in London. And we're trying to develop this thing called a fidelity index, which just looks at what are the other underlying factors that might affect antimicrobial stewardship, so that we can kind of tease out, you know, what has been an impact of the tool and what's an impact of kind of all of the other things. And that underlying kind of data extract will kind of support that. One other thing we have to think about, which I think is increasingly going to happen in informatics, is does the tool actually form a medical device? And it's worth going, if you haven't already done so, go and look at the MHRA flow chart for medical devices and just have a think about things that you may be building or building into your system. Does that constitute a device? And we thought quite clearly could it. It didn't. But when we went through, it was kind of a grey area. But ultimately, we come to the consensus that it wasn't, because medical staff still make a decision at the end. Two things that we're working on are kind of training materials and thinking about whether we develop a kind of a national guidance website for information on AMS, so that the hyperlinks that are built into the tool, everyone goes to the same point and we kind of share the benefits of scale for having something kind of centrally. So the idea is to kind of put this into a pilot area, see how it goes, you know, revise the tool, and then kind of share that with other sites. And a key factor in that is how interoperable is the tool that we've built. So the general concept is we've kind of kept it simple. The plans that we've kind of built in, I can export them out of kind of my Cerner system, email them to colleagues who can then kind of pull them into their system and then just do some localization, because there may be subtle differences in terms of their nomenclature. And obviously the further we get down, you know, kind of DM&D standards, the greater that interoperability will be. So if we can kind of jump to the next slide, and I'm nearly done. So as I say, we're going to scale that up to kind of three kind of main clinical areas. We've got two medical wards, and then we've got heme oncology. We picked those because they're kind of relatively self-contained. And in terms of heme onc, they've got high antimicrobial usage, but they've got a kind of a limited range of antibiotics. So it's a kind of a good way to kind of review that. And then the idea is to kind of extend it to other sites, initially with Cerner, but the idea is to kind of create a blueprint that could then be transferred into other systems, you know, pop it into JSC and see kind of what you can take and what you can't take and get an understanding of that, and then review that with the fidelity index. And then the last one in terms of future development is the plan format that we've gone for. We've kept kind of relatively simple, and we've kept a kind of a core framework that all antibiotics share, but there is the ability within kind of our system to have kind of smart rules which filter what's presented within the plan based on underlying kind of patient parameters. So if patients have got a low EGFR, you know, give them specific dosing advice based on that, or limit it to be particular kind of clinical areas. But obviously, the more we build in, the bigger the maintenance burden is. We've got to make sure it works before we look to develop that. And that's kind of all I wanted to say. I apologize for the problems in kind of jumping on the call. Is there any questions?
Hi, Andrew. Thank you. I know we've had lots of difficulty in terms of technology, but thank you for stepping in. And thank you, Robin, as well, for starting the presentation off. And I think there's quite a few questions, and people, I think you've answered it, talking about whether EPAMS will be available for other systems. I know that you're trialing it out within Newcastle, and then hopefully see how it may do in other Cerner systems. And using those principles, so that other vendors will be able to use the system as well.
Yeah, and that kind of blueprint model. So part of the project is to create a kind of a technical specification of what's in there, with a little kind of indication of what are the underlying requirements that you might need. So to take it to another level, you might need, you know, culture and sensitivity level results getting into the system, the ability to interact with them. But if you haven't got that, then you can't take that piece. But at least that blueprint model allows you to kind of pick and choose what you're able to get.
Okay, that's great. I'm looking at the time and I know we have to move on. There are other questions in the chat. Will you be able to answer some of the questions? And even if you won't be able to answer them now, we can send them out to the delegates. And again, we just want to say thank you for joining us, even though you've had difficulties.
Yeah, no problem. Just send the questions by email and then I'll kind of reply to them and then answer it that way.
That's great. We'll send it to you and we'll send it to our delegates. Hi, Robin.
Could you share our emails if people wanted to contact us, or shall I maybe post them in the as an answer?
If you can post them the answer, but I also send it out as well to the delegates in the Wellington. Okay. Sarah, would you be able to move on to the next slide? Okay, and so we've just got a couple of announcements. Feedback from our learning event that we had earlier last month, the 27th April, for the Transforming Lives with Digital Medicines, and from the masterclasses, is that everyone values wants a place where people can network, share experiences, and also learn from each other, whether you're in the implementation stage, optimization or procurement stage of your digital medicine systems or your EPMA systems. We're looking to relaunch our community of interest space within the NHS Futures website, and we would value your opinions on what we should include or what would be of interest to you. So there's a short survey. If you can see on the screen, there's a short URL that you can type in. If you can fill in, it's about filling the survey. It's about 3 or 4 questions, just asking you what do you want and what would you like to see. And we want the network to work for you. So please, anyone who's interested, please complete the survey. And any feedback would be great. Next slide, please. Okay, and again, we're also the Digital Interoperable Medicines team also doing workshops looking at how we can benefit you and asking you for your support and feedback and with the adoption of different IT systems. We're having a series of workshops and we would like people from within the system, within the NHS and beyond to be able to come in and ask to take part in those workshops. There is a link down below. So if you're interested in taking part of any of the workshops, can you please again just click on that link and just put your details in and someone will get back to you. Okay, next slide. Okay. So I don't know if many of you know that Anne is retiring this week and she's next to me. So I just want everyone to say bye. She's over 30 years of dedication to the NHS, starting off at the Wirral, and she's made such a massive contribution to pharmacy and the digital medicines world. Anyone who speaks about Anne speaks so highly of her and all the support that she's given us over the last 30 years and more. She's been instrumental in setting this masterclass up, as well as the Digital Medicines Learning Network. As many of you know, she's instrumental in the ePrescribing toolkits as well, and so much more. She's done so much more and beyond that. And so I just want everyone to take part and just say, well done, if you can put your comments in chat, and that you should relax, unwind, and enjoy your retirement. And you'll be missed. The ePrescribing Masterclass is still carrying on and Anne will just be missed. So if everyone can join me and say bye to Anne and good luck.
Thank you. And thank you everybody for all the support over the last little while. This is a surprise, Steph. Now I know why you wanted me to join you, but keep up the good work, everybody. And I know that over the next few months with all the work that's happened, the foundations both for interoperability and that goal that we've all aimed for with moving information around the system, of a consolidated medication record and also accessing EPS to support secondary care are now starting to become a reality. The first sites are starting to really show the true benefits and are starting to deliver. But thank you all for your support and for all the feedback that's helped us put in place everything that I hope has been helpful to you. So thank you, and I shall enjoy the rest, Steph, definitely.
Thank So on that note, we're going to close today's masterclass. Thank you again for everyone who's taken part, and thank you to our speakers. The next masterclass is on the 13th of July from 1 to 2. If you would like to take part or have any ideas for any future topics, feedback, or would like to present, please email Sarah Black and the emails on the screen. Again, please use the hashtag ePrescribing Masterclass, whether that's on Twitter or LinkedIn or any other social medias. Please spread the word and join the digital learning network on NHS Futures. Thank you and goodbye.